Right at the beginning of this presentation, I would want to say that I am not a historian, but rather a writer with more than a passing interest in history. And as such, my presentation is more along the lines of what I have come to understand about history and its significance to us as Salvationists. There is no doubt many reasons why we record history, but it may well be that recording Christian history takes on another dimension. Crucial to Jewish culture is the call to remember, particularly Israel's deliverance from Egypt, celebrated every year, even up until today, in the Passover. The Old Testament rings time and time again with the call to remember or forget not. To God's people, history and its meaning were of paramount importance. The writer of Exodus sets out quite distinctly the necessity of recalling the history of God's goodness to the nation of Israel and the process that would be implemented to remember the Passover. Remember, these instructions are a permanent law that you and your descendants must observe forever. I suspect that such a command given by God has great significance, the like of which we dare not ignore. It seems to me that the history of the Exodus was so crucial in the mind of God that he wanted all succeeding generations to know and celebrate it. It may well be that in observing the history surrounding the Passover, we can better understand the relevance and cruciality of religious history, particularly the history of the Salvation Army. I believe the observance of the Passover sets the background for the understanding of religious history, the imperative to remember the goodness of God.
Holy words,
There is a qualifier here. History and tradition do not have the authority of the Word of God. Rather, they simply remind us of God's goodness to us over the years. Just over 10 years ago, I was approached and asked if I would be willing to produce a video to celebrate the 125th anniversary of the Salvation Army on Sydney's northern beaches. The events that surround the Army's activity in the area are crucial to the development of the early Salvation Army in Australia. The complete video runs for around 40 minutes, and we shall just look at some selected clips. Most events in life have something to teach us if we are willing to learn. The research and production of A Cup of Compassion has reinforced some of the lessons I have learnt about history. Knowledge that perhaps was not new to me, but reaffirmed in my thinking. A Cup of Compassion reaffirms a great biblical truth reflected in the words of Jesus in Matthew 10:42 about a cup of cold water in his name. If you give even a cup of cold water to one of the least of my followers, you will surely be rewarded. Only eternity will reveal the impact of often the simplest and most basic acts of Christian compassion. The video, I hope, clearly demonstrates this kingdom truth. The retelling of this historical event and the panorama of ministry that has flowed from it validates the utilization of history as a powerful tool in Christian ministry.
Salvation Army ministry on the northern beaches of Sydney commenced, as it did so often, by a simple act of compassion. A cup of tea for a sick, lonely old lady. One simple act of kindness, performed ignorant of its extraordinary outcome, established on Sydney's northern beaches a substantial real estate holding for the Army. The land was to become not only a centre for Salvation Army ministry, but also a valuable resource which would financially empower the fledgling organisation.
Elizabeth Jenkins was a remarkable person, and the Army has every reason to be grateful for her. But she was a very odd person in many ways. She was a religious extremist. She refused to let her boat go out to rescue some sailors because it was Sabbath and that would be working on the Sabbath. Her will left everything to the Army and was disputed by a brother and went to court and so on, but it wasn't the large areas of land that had already come into the Army's possession.
From war cry reports in early 1912, it appears that there were significant Salvation Army social enterprises in operation, including a sanatorium for inebriates, home for boys, ladies' holiday home, industrial farm, and Florence House, a home for girls.
From what I can understand, the earliest use for the Salvation Army of Elizabeth Jenkins' properties was the building of the Home of Rest in DY, which had been a number of things. It started as a Home of Rest and then it became a, what was it called? It had a particular name, like a sanatorium, but for people who were suffering from alcoholism. And then later on, they built Florence House, which I think was the first men's aged care home in this territory, certainly in this state.
Not a great deal is known about early camps on the Collaroy site, but it is believed to be the oldest Christian campsite in Australia, with utilisation of the site dating back to 1906. The first camps were bush camps held under canvas with a minimum of sophistication. The annual music camp has for many young Salvationists been an opportunity to not only enhance their musical capabilities, but also an opportunity to meet new friends.
Some of the outstanding memories are like relationships, you know, getting to meet other people from other corps, people from rural corps in particular. I guess the most outstanding memory for me is that I met my wife at music camp. The other outstanding memory is that I said yes to the call of God on my life to full-time ministry as a Salvation Army officer at music camp.
Development of Salvation Army ministry on the northern beaches owes much to Elizabeth Jenkins and the estate she bequeathed, particularly in the area of aged care.
Naturally, after so many years, the old men's home at Florence House needed to be replaced. So Nielsen Warren was engaged as the architect, and they built a new place for those men to be called Elizabeth Jenkins Place, which is closer to the campsite. Now, the interesting thing is, as part of his original brief, it was to be for these older men. And if you worked in homeless men's, like at Foster House and other places, you'd know that they'd been there so long that they'd got used to one another, they got used to noises. So one of the things he did was he made some of the walls fairly thin so they could hear one another.
Opened on the 12th of April 1975 at Collaroy, Elizabeth Jenkins Place, an aged care facility named after its benefactor, was to provide a meaningful and crucial ministry to the frail and aged.
On the northern beaches, we had a lovely nursing home and hostel called Elizabeth Jenkins Place in honour of Elizabeth Jenkins, who gave us the land. It housed elderly people. I think it was 113 rooms of hostel accommodation and 40-bed nursing home for the elderly.
On Saturday, 14th of September 1912, then, a new hall was opened for the Manly Corps. As Manly's popularity grew as a resort location, Salvation Army Open Air Ministry became an important part of not only the Corps agenda, but also became a focus for divisional and territorial initiatives with other Corps and cadets from the training college who took part.
It was our privilege in 1959 to be moved from Dalby to Manly. And we were not there very long before we came to appreciate the tremendous opportunity through open air ministry, but also the excellent groundwork that had been put in earlier years, some outstanding officers. And we worked away at the open airs morning, afternoon and night. And the open air had a distinctive style. The Corps officer did the whole open air, using, of course, the band. Timbrels were very, very popular.
As I am today, almost 80, if I start thinking about the Corps program at DY, it makes me feel very, very tired. And it makes me wonder how on earth we ever did it. Now, however you grew an Army Corps on that, I don't know. But that was the program, and it worked.
The ripple effects of a cup of compassion are still felt over 100 years after a Salvation Army officer offered a cup of tea to a sick old lady.
Many people question the relevance and significance of documenting and disseminating history and see little point in the time and effort spent researching and publishing it. If historical research is nothing more than listing dates, facts, and anecdotes from the past, then it may well have little relevance to a practical and active movement like the Salvation Army. However, history is far more than curiosity, for hidden away in the dusty archives are stories, facts and data that will enable contemporary Salvationists to not only understand the ethos of the organisation, but also find empowerment for ministry today. Like many of my age group, I grew up on a diet of Salvation Army history and doctrine through directory and corps cadets. Booklets such as Victory and Liberty series were staple fodder for young Salvationists in my early and formative years. Today, such information is not so easily available or perhaps utilised or even desired by young Salvationists, and we may well have generations that have little knowledge and understanding of the Salvation Army history and its development. Very early on, our pioneer Salvationist came to understand the indelible nexus between faith and simple trust, and that belief unleashed a potent energy that drove the early ministry of the Salvation Army to great heights. The incredible greatness of God's power has in no way been diminished, nor has the availability and dynamism of the Holy Spirit. The only thing lacking is our humility to take God at His word and our determination to follow the simple example of our pioneers. We need to recapture that simplistic and innate sense of belief which energized our fledgling movement. My research has led me to understand that the early Salvation Army had an active energy and spirit that was unique and empowering. And there is a real need for us to keep alive that same energy and empowering today. Alexis de Tocqueville was a French aristocrat, philosopher, diplomat, political scientist, and best known for his work, Democracy in America, in which he says, "When the past no longer illuminates the future, the spirit walks in darkness." I have this sense that somewhere in the dusty tomes and archives of history, we may well rediscover not only our heritage, but also our corporate identity. While some of the methods that made us so highly successful in our early years may have little relevance today, the principles and innovative mindset behind them can be re-employed to bring us once again to the cutting edge of evangelism and ministry. History reminds us of where we have come from, our roots, and our heritage. It reminds us of the battles fought, the victories won, and yes, the failures that were inevitable in any organisation developing as quickly as the 19th century Salvation Army. It reminds us that many of the liberties, privileges, and high public profile we enjoy today were accomplished by those faithful Salvationists who have gone before us. The Greek philosopher Aristotle said, "If you would understand anything, observe its beginning and its development." In an era when many organisations seem to be struggling with their identity, a comprehensive understanding of our history could be the catalyst needed for the Salvation Army to become more relevant to our age. Our relevance to the present age rests heavily on knowing who we are and understanding the events that made us what we are today. Without appreciating those qualities that moulded and shaped our movement, it may be difficult to not only understand where we fit into today's culture, but perhaps more importantly, how we can serve and minister within it. The Salvation Army in Australia did not develop in a vacuum. It was impacted by the influences at work among the emerging nation. Despite its British trappings, the Salvation Army in our region developed its own identity and style of Salvationism. There is a sense in which the Army's development became enmeshed in the emerging nation and became in no small way part of the fabric of the Australian way of life. There is no greater way of being relevant than being part of the fabric of that community. History can provide us with an indicator for the future. In coming to understand the past with all its nuances, we are empowered to plot a path on which we can move forward with a significant degree of confidence. The American novelist Robert Penn Warren wrote a novel called All the King's Men, and this fiction novel has a historical basis, and he wrote, "History cannot give us a program for the future, but it can give us a fuller understanding of ourselves and our common humanity so that we can better face the future." I sense that younger generations are looking for direction for their lives and for their Salvation Army. There is an intense desire within them to know and understand what motivated the early Salvation Army, and in some sense recapture something of that innovative and Holy Spirit inspired enthusiasm. It may well be, in coming to understand our history, they will not only find and soak up something of the early spirit of Salvationism, but will also reinvigorate our movement. We, who are the gatekeepers of that historical knowledge, have the responsibility to pass on that knowledge in a manner that relates to and is comprehended by contemporary generations. The challenge is, how do we communicate the simple lessons of history in this digital age, with its emphasis on visual and social media? Someone has said that those who fail to learn the lessons of history are bound to repeat them. As old and perhaps overused as the quote is, the reality is that it is absurdly true. To learn these lessons, they need repeating, perhaps in a more new and relevant way, but nevertheless, they need to be continually repeated and reaffirmed. Let me return to where I commenced, the recurring call of the Old Testament to remember or forget not his story. The corollary of this is that our story, the story of the Salvation Army, is part of his story. As the old song reminds us, "Tell me the story often, for I forget so soon."
Thank you.
history. What's the point? Well, here's the point. We need to be regularly reminded of God's goodness to us. And the history of the Salvation Army on Sydney's northern beaches forcibly reminds us that at a crucial point in the early development of the army, through the generosity of Elizabeth Jenkins, God provided a timely provision which underwrote much of the necessary resources the fledgling organisation needed. And as the song has reminded us, tell me the story often, for I forget so soon.